Hey everyone, I wanted to take a moment to thank our sponsor of the Stirfry, Nuclear Printing. They're your go-to custom apparel business, specializing in custom t-shirts, hoodies, hats, and more for your business, brand, or any occasion. Check them out on Instagram, at Nuclear Printing. They are an amazing business with great customer support, so make sure you check them out. What is up, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of the Stirfry. It's your boy, Chef T.
And Will the Space Kid.
And then our special guest, Casey Seaborn, a.k.a. Casey in Cleveland. What's up, Casey? How you doing?
Doing wonderful. It's a great day to be here. I mean, just positive enthusiasm. Yeah. Excited to get this rolling. First ever podcast appearance. So
yeah, thanks for being here. It's a great day. A great day to be alive. Why don't you start out by telling the audience a little bit about yourself?
So, it started actually just across the road at Hillcrest Hospital, December 16th, 94. No, I'm not going to go that story. But, no, I mean, Northeast Ohio native, born and raised, Mentor, Mayfield, grew up in this area, lived in Canton for 4 years while I was at school at Walsh University. One of those things where just kind of done a lot of things in my life. The student athlete, entrepreneur, started businesses, had many experiences. But really, I mean, right now, flash forward, I mean, I'm a couple years removed from graduation.
Right.
Have my own business. I'm partnered with a startup that I'm running the business development for, and then a head coach at a lacrosse program. So I'm a man of many talents, many skills and experiences. I just do it all, and that's kind of always how it's been. Jack of all trades and a master of some type, you know, just one of those types. So
of course. Who inspires you? I know you're big into entrepreneurship, coaching, motivation. What inspires you or who inspires you?
I say one of my biggest inspirations, first and foremost, is family. I mean, I have a pretty extended and distant family. I mean, 20 plus cousins on just my mom's side alone. And then the dad's side, it's not a whole lot of, you know, family ties, kind of separated, moved on throughout, you know, the years. But really just family. And by family, I mean, you know, my sister, my brother-in-law, my mom and dad. I mean, it's just,
right.
I saw them work from such a long age and such a young age. I saw my dad as a Cleveland police officer with overtime and working every day and night. My mom as a nurse working in, you know, downtown in Cleveland Clinic, running an ER. And it just inspired a work ethic in me. So really just that family, just wanting to do it for them, just to make them proud. And that's always been a huge motivator. I've always been success motivated, but I've always had that family motivation too as a big part of it. And
yeah, it's important.
Yeah, and I would say if there's other motivators, though, influences. I mean, Gary Vee's been one of those guys when I really think, you know, Gary Vaynerchuk, he's been a lifesaver for me personally, was from understanding who I am and developing, you know, my path into entrepreneurship and becoming really self-aware in my life of, you know, the who, what, when, where, and why of what I want out of my life, where am I going, and what makes me happy. So
yeah, I mean, there's a lot of, so one of my things about Gary Vee, I know he preaches hustle. Do you think there is a fine line between hustle and then taking time for yourself? Like, maybe it's not always the best to continuously hustle and wear yourself out. Where do you find that balance?
Oh, of course, of course. No, I think that's where a lot of people misconstrue some of those messages. Because especially in our day and age, you hear it in the music, you hear it in rap.
Sound bites, right?
Exactly.
They're not hearing the whole thing.
No, and it's always that, oh, you got to hustle till you grind your face off, 16-hour days. And it's like, that is a part of entrepreneurship. I'd be lying if I said it wasn't, but it's not about grinding to that. It's about happiness and self-fulfillment. If working 16-hour days is what makes you happy and you love it, go do it. No one says you have to go to the bar and drink if you don't want to do those things. And it's more of the, if you're complaining, you need to look in areas of your life. Are you hustling? Are you doing everything you can seriously to really be successful? Are you doing the things in your life that really are fostering that growth and personal challenge and really just that whole stay hard principle? Are you really trying to challenge yourself every day in, day out to get to a best version of you?
Yeah.
And that's where people have that misconception, entrepreneurship. You have to hustle. And it's like, no, I mean, I started many of my businesses just 1 or 2 hours a day when I was working a full-time job or being a student athlete in high school and college. And it was, I did those things just like people, you know, write music or play video games or go out to the bar and drink.
Well,
it's what makes me happy.
When did you kind of like reach that breaking point? You said you get motivated by family a lot, but I feel like it's a point where people say, I don't want to just keep going through jobs, getting higher positions.
Honestly, I've always had the seeds there. I've always had that seed where I knew I had to do what made what was authentic to me, what I want to do in life. But I came from an environment that was, you know, ultra conservative. You know, police officer dad, mom that had gone to school. You know, nobody in the Seaborn family had ever had a college degree. I'm the first male in Seaborn last name in our entire family that ever graduated college. And it was go down that road. Thank you. Go down that road.
Definitely congrats.
You know, I drank, partied in school, but I did pretty good in school. You know, I had a good time. But it was one of those experiences that I really loved my experience in college. And I think it was huge and one of the biggest indicators of why I'm successful now. And I needed college. And
that's something that
you hear entrepreneurs, they say, well, you don't really need to go to college. It's like, not necessarily. You don't have to go to college, but college might be the right option for you. And kind of going back to your question, I really had to distance that self really senior year of college. I mean, I was anxious. I was in a mental low. I was in an all-time low, like going down a path of public accounting, going to be a CPA like I had studied. I had taken 18 credit hours every semester in college, and I was like, I don't want to do this. I know I don't want to do this. I'm literally working a public accounting internship spring of my senior year of college, and I'm like, I got to reevaluate some things. I don't know what I want to do, and, and it really prompted a lot of the things I've done, and I said – and I remember calling my mom and, you know, I had said I was 99% sure I was going to live in Canton, start, build a business while working public accounting. And I didn't. Oh, complete 180. You know, I decided I'm going to move back home. I'm going to spend that time with my family. I'm going to figure out what I really want in life. I'm going to take those 6 months off because I had a little bit of an atypical life. You know, in high school, I wasn't going out and partying. I was working Dunkin' Donuts or working a full-time job while being a student athlete and then honors classes and that and getting as many experiences as I could because that's always what's made me happy. I've always been that type of person where I need to have multiple things going on in my life that – or I just kind of get, I guess, just pigeonholed on one thing and I get just bored and just uninspired and just unmotivated. And it's
I mean, that's good though. It's good to take that step.
Mm-hmm.
And some people aren't willing to take that and move back home. You know, they go to college. They feel like, you know, they graduate with thousands of dollars in debt. And they're afraid to move back home because what is everyone going to think about me? What is that going to happen to my image, how I feel, all that type of thing.
I mean, it's definitely frowned upon in society. Yeah. Like, the whole you know, idea – oh, person graduated from college. They're about to get that job right away. Not months away, away.
No, it's right away.
And exactly. And there's this point, though. It's crazy because college has a crazy perception. It's either you're most likely two ways. You know, you perceive college, oh, great, you're going to get hella money. And then, or you don't go to school. You're like, I'm going to grind, do my tech job. It'll pay off more. But I think people that like say, oh, I don't want to go to college, they look even at the person that went to college and does not have a job right away as less, though. You know, it's crazy because you have two things going at someone that just graduated from college. You have people that graduate and have jobs, and they're looking at this person like, what are you doing, man? Like, I have this job in accounting. And then the person that graduated high school and is working is like, oh, look at him. He's thousands of dollars in debt. He shouldn't go to college. You know, there's this, like, negative stigma to college grads and it can be rough mental health-wise.
Yeah, and I really feel like that's so prevalent in our day and age. Everyone's so ready to just jump and be that first response and that whole woke culture where it's like people forget to take in context. You know, for instance, I had job offers my senior year of college before I even started for $60,000, $70,000 a year. Was it things I wanted to do? Not necessarily, but I knew those things were there. That's why I picked accounting. I knew when I was in business school and at Mentor, actually, they had a career tech program where you could be business education, much like they have welding, nursing, auto body, all those at different career centers. We had a marketing education, so it was cool. All right, you go to class for five classes junior year, and you only have two classes senior year. You get to go out and work. That's an entrepreneur's dream for somebody who couldn't stand high school and that formal schooling process. Always had been an honor student, decent grades, but never did my homework. Couldn't stand it. Hated it. I already did this stuff in school. Why am I going home to do it again? Or you know what I mean?
It
was one of those things where people just don't take in that context. Luckily, I had that exposure early on. And I decided to go to college. I'm like, if I'm going to go to college, because my primary motivator for going to college wasn't school. It was actually I wanted to be a student athlete. When I picked up lacrosse freshman year of high school, I said to that day, I said, this is a sport that I'm going to play in college. I had stopped football. I had just come off an injury for basketball. I realized, you know, I'm a 6'2" guy who was a, you know, a big man in the post. I wasn't going to make it very far in basketball. So I said, you know, lacrosse is my sport. I just fell in love with it, was a natural on it. And I said, I'm going to play this in college. So I said, if I'm going to college, I'm going to study something that is a tradable, marketable skill. I'm not going to go get a degree in marketing or management or theory. I'm going to learn accounting because I already had a knack for it. I was pretty good at it, and I really looked. I still have the spreadsheet to this day. I did senior year of high school. I looked at about 100 CEOs, entrepreneurs, inventors, investors, all those types that I was really, you know, admired and really aspired to be like in business. And I looked, and about 60% of them had degrees or formal studies in accounting at some point in their life, either accounting or finance. And I realized, you know, wow, if I know accounting and finance, yeah, exactly. I can be a CEO. I can run a business because if you can look at a balance sheet and income statement and you can look at the financials, you can understand the picture of that business.
That's right, the definition of a business, right, is making money.
Exactly.
If you understand how money works, mm-hmm. then you're that much more ahead of someone who doesn't understand.
And at the very least, struggling through all those for thinking I was going to be a CPA prepared me where it's like, now I know how to itemize all my taxes. I know how to get the most bang for my buck. I know how to like advise clients when they're having an accounting issue. I know how to help myself with those and be proactive. And I preach this, especially when I go, I'm actually going at the end of the month to speak at Walsh again for, they have what's called Professor for a Day. Alumni get to come back and teach class. And one of the biggest things about is, I've left 2 60,000+ jobs out of college right away. And I realized, and people, I always get that look like, what is this guy nuts? Like he graduated and he had job offers. Then I said, I left them because they weren't right for me. I knew it's not what I wanted. And I tell everybody, the one thing you do in college, the bare minimum is graduation with that piece of paper. Everybody always says, oh, that piece of paper is not worth it. It isn't. It's the experience behind that piece of paper. The people you meet, the people you contact, the experiences you have, the internships, that's where the value is. And I always say, you better be, and I talk to the students, if you take anything out of my speech today, you should be introducing yourself with everybody on campus. Don't think you're too good to talk to somebody. You don't know who's the next Steve Jobs or who's the next entrepreneur or investor or someone who might be a partner in your business later on.
Right.
And it's just that whole idea of doing things because they're the right thing to do, having that moral conscience, and then trying to bring value, that 51-49 principle that I've adopted where every interaction I'm in, whether it's business, life, personal, social, I always try to give 1% more than the other person. If I'm getting 49% back of the deal, they're getting 51 every single time. And I think those are a lot of those self-awareness keys that you just have to have. If you're going to go in this, if you're just gonna thinking if you want to go to college or not, you have to have those understandings.
Yeah. So let me think. So entrepreneurship... So what do you think, you're big in entrepreneurship, what do you think is the reason why people don't pursue it in college? So they get a degree and they're passively, you know, they're passively getting their degree, they're going out partying, they don't you really do anything towards it, you know, why do you think people don't want to choose the entrepreneurship route?
I think it's one of two reasons, and it's really, it's either one, they just don't know, it's kind of like, well, you don't know what your favorite food was. For instance, my favorite chips are probably Fritos. I love Fritos. But if I had never tasted Fritos before,
you would know.
How would I know if those are my favorite food or, you know, how I love fillets and such?
Good metaphor.
Or it's the fact that people think it's just not attainable for them. They never scratch that itch because, much like me, they come from a background where, what do you mean? That doesn't make sense. They allow their insecurities to manifest into their day-to-day thought, actions, and conscious awareness where they think, it's not even a possibility to me, you know, and I think that's where I see it all the time. And I really believe that entrepreneurship can be taught, but you have to have those entrepreneurial tendencies, awareness, and idea. Like I said, for instance, I'm doing best when I'm doing multiple things at once and juggling. In my definition, entrepreneur, that's literally what an entrepreneur is. You're one of those people that struggles with balance. You're one of those people that is so interested in everything. Like, for instance, I always say, I knew as an entrepreneur when I was able to spend 4 hours on Wikipedia just going from link to link and reading like an encyclopedia and understanding the information. It's just that unknown and that problem solving is really what makes an entrepreneur. But if you never scratch that itch, how do you know? You know what I mean? It's kind of like being a musician or a filmmaker. If you never picked up that camera, I remember we talked a couple months ago, you're like, I just picked it up and I started doing it. I found a knack for it. And now look what you've been able to build around that.
Yeah.
If you never picked up that camera, you wouldn't be here right now. We wouldn't be here.
And it's
crazy to think. And it's like people get so caught up in the day to day that they don't think of the long term vision in their mind. And it's like you have to have that long term vision. You can't let it overwhelm you, but you got to have that reminder of the day to day, living in that day to day with the long term vision in mind. And I think that's why so many entrepreneurs just never get that start. I mean, I tell people all the time, a kid I coach, he's now going to Walsh. He's followed in my footsteps. He's playing lacrosse at Walsh. He's studying. He just switched to accounting from being an engineer because he's like, I don't want to do that. And I said, Tyler, you're an entrepreneur. You know that, right? He's like, what? I was like, you know you're going to be that kid that's going to run a business to do that because, one, you don't want to work for anybody else. One, you like your freedom and you're a smart kid. And two, you're willing to do anything, which really opens up a lot of possibilities. And he's like, I really think I am. I was like, exactly. And I told him, here, talk to Dr. Kim, who's one of my mentors at Walsh, who's big in entrepreneurship. You know, this is a kid who was a Korean immigrant from Philadelphia, failed out of high school, almost barely went to college. And now he's a doctorate, published author, entrepreneur, speaker, and all that. And I said, you need to get contact with him and just start learning. Be an open book and sponge and be open to every experience you possibly can be in. And same thing. He said, at the very least, I wanted to be here to play lacrosse. I'm studying accounting because now I have a skill. If I need to pursue my dreams, I know there's a $45,000 to a $60,000 job at the end of this road that I can use to jumpstart my career with whatever it is I want to do. And it's crazy to think, like, wow, I was just in that position 6 years ago. At the beginning of the decade, I was in high school. Like, it's just, it's crazy to think, 2011, I'm a junior in high school. Like, it's just, you don't, or actually sophomore, it's like, you just can't comprehend that. It's like, now I've gone from the student to the learner, to now the teacher, coach, and mentor. And it's like,
yeah,
just flip the script. And it's just something that's been natural to me.
So, you know, with you being an entrepreneur, what do you consider your biggest risk that you want to speak on?
I mean, obviously, I could say financial risk, but honestly, financial risks, as long as you're taking them and being smart about it, they're not a huge risk because the ROI is always there in the long term, as long as you're investing in the right types of things. If you're not trying to make a quick buck, and you understand that in the long game, the pennies don't matter. It's the big lump sums that do. You're going to be more apt to invest. You're going to be more apt to do that. So I'd say the biggest risk is self-destruction. Too many entrepreneurs, they quit too early. You know, they think, well, this is my dream. This is what I want to do. I want to be a filmmaker. But then they stop emailing people for a job, or they stop doing that initiative after 30, 50 tries. It's like, if this is really your passion and what you really want to do, nothing else is going to get in the way. Like, for me, and many entrepreneurs view it, entrepreneurship isn't a risk at all, because there's nothing else in this realm that really will give that fulfillment, success, and happiness in our lives that we can do outside of this. So there is no other option. And it's like, you don't want to ever choose something out of desperation. You want to choose it out of situational awareness, that it's like, of course this is what I'm going to be. Yeah. You know, it's like, my sister's a nurse and she struggled in school all those years, and now she's an ICU nurse literally right over there at Hillcrest. And it's like, she was never good at school, but she was always meant to be a caretaker, healthcare provider, and a nurse,
just like my mom. People are meant to do certain things,
I really believe there's a higher power that helps influence that. As long as you have, like I said, right intentions and right direction, things will fall into place with the right effort and perception.
So what do you think are three of the most important characteristics of being an entrepreneur?
First and foremost, self-awareness. You have to be self-aware. If you don't understand who you are, what you want, where you want to go, and how you react to certain situations and that feedback, it's going to be a really tough road. And that's something I had to learn when I first started. So I always say self-awareness, mindset, and experience. You have to have that self-awareness. You have to have a rock-solid mindset and be able to be your biggest fan, your biggest critic, while also not self-destructing and also not patting your ego. And essentially by that, I mean, is you can't get too high on your own supply, but you can't beat yourself up, and you have to have that ebb and flow and that balance. And then third, that experience is, you have to get as many experiences, be open to experiences, and just try, because you're never going to know. You know, for instance, I started in entrepreneurship after I quit my ERP and consulting job. I started it by just starting Coach Casey Lacrosse on Instagram. I said, you know what? I can provide a lot by helping kids and being able to coach kids and help them by just doing this stuff, documenting literally what I'm already doing as a coach with the fitness, the training, strength conditioning, and individual training. It's like, I just started that, and that segue into Casey in Cleveland and so many different things. And I didn't just said I'm going to start. I honestly don't believe I'd be sitting where I am right here with just that Coach Casey. And many people would view that as a failure. I didn't make much money from it. I tested some things. I learned how to build attention, build awareness, build a brand, and those type of things. But I only made like a couple grand from it in the course of like 5-6 months. Most people be like, oh, I'm a failure. I can't do this in entrepreneurship. But I had that mindset set that, no, for better or worse, I am an entrepreneur. For better or worse, this is what I am, and there's no other way I can do it. So just keep going. And that's really what allowed me to start Casey in Cleveland and then have this opportunity with OnTech and be a head coach. I really believe that success breeds success. But if you self-destruct and you're not secure from the start, it's going to be really, really tough to ever have that actualization of, you know, success and self-worth in entrepreneurship without the experiences behind
Casey
it.
Casey in Cleveland. Mm-hmm. So is that a team of people? Are there other people like behind the scenes?
Not at the moment. I do have, for instance, I have, you know, a value network is what I like to call it. Like,
okay.
I know electricians, you know, I know fencing guys, I know videographers, I know producers and music. And what my whole aspect of Casey in Cleveland, the reason I started was I wanted to find a way. Obviously, it started as just a personal brand. Everybody, you got to have that personal brand. Right, you hear everybody say. And what it manifested is to, I have a lot of experiences that most people don't have at 25. I have a lot of skills, understanding, and perceptions that just aren't common. And I figured, what is the best way that I can provide value, attention, and awareness to musicians, creatives, those go-getters just like me that want to do something bigger than the normal script. They want to do something more than just go to that college. They really said, I can't do this. I can't be A and B. I'm creating my C path. I'm going my own way. I'm doing my own thing. And I said, I know I can bring value. I don't know how I can yet. So I'm going to start just by interacting. And I mean, I've already helped, you know, musicians get videos. I've already helped awareness with brands, obviously investing in some projects and some films. And it's like, I've just started it. And it's now manifest where it has the opportunity to be a whole company that's going to be able to provide managerial and advising services to those creative go-getter types. And that's, like I said, any of those types that really want more than just the ordinary life, but don't know where to get it from.
And you
want to
keep building that. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then that goes with, you know, Casey in Cleveland, coaching, all that types of stuff. And you right now, you do coach lacrosse, right?
Yep. Yeah. I'm the head coach at Chardon High School, you know, just about 20 miles up north of here, just south of Mentor, where I'm from.
Why did you decide to be a coach?
You know, I've always felt that I've had a knack for coaching. I've always been that friend that people confide in. They ask for advice, they look for help, you know, that really was that empathetic, caring person that was always, you know, what's going on, man? Or you'd sit with that person in the lunchroom just because, I don't know, I grew up that way, you know, that conservative, hey, everybody's family, just be nice, treat people how you want to be treated. And it really started from there. And I said, you know what? I stopped playing college lacrosse after 2 years and hurt my back, was in the wrong situation on the team, just wasn't the right team culture that I wanted, but I wanted to stay at Walsh. I didn't want to transfer and go play anywhere else. So I said, I'm going to stay here. And still to this day, I have no regrets about stopping playing because, yeah, I only played, you know, 6 total years in the sport, but now I can have 30, 40, 50 years as a coach influencing and having more of an impact than anything I could have ever done as a player. And really, it just started naturally. I mean, I graduated in 2017. I'd started my ERP consulting job in Chardon, and one of my friends was coaching the head coach that I played with at Mentor. He was a couple years older, coaching at Chardon. I started as the assistant coach and defensive coordinator because I was like, yeah, I want to get back involved with the game. I love the sport.
Yeah, that's wonderful.
I've been involved ever since.
Are you ever just like at random places, kind of have like a brain blast about the team? Like, I got this new strategy.
Absolutely.
Yeah, as soon as I see those kids.
I feel like when you're taking the deuce, that's the best time to go with the idea.
No, I mean, I got lots of toilet thinking, lots of shower thinking. And it's like, honestly, I do that all the time. I really have always thought of myself as like almost like the Terminator, where it's like I just have that ability to look and just kind of look off to the side and think and do those computations and just kind of that pattern recognition almost, where you're able to say, oh, I can find something from a Samsung phone and this, what I found here, this process relates to the business, but I can actually use that strategy as organizational leadership as a coach. And it's like, that's one of those unwritten skills and those special abilities that I really think entrepreneurs have, where it's like pattern recognition is a huge thing of what we do. I mean, it's just like Netflix. Netflix didn't do anything new. They didn't reinvent movies or anything. They just reinvented how they thought, well, people want subscription. People don't care about going to the movie store like Blockbuster thought. People care about having access to content and all the videos. Convenience. You now automated that, sending it to your house, and there's no late fees back then. It's crazy because some people would be like, wait, what do you mean? Netflix sent DVDs? Yeah, they did. And then they grew where it's like, you have this content, and now look at them. Netflix is now just like Warner Brothers or any of those other production studios where they're producing original content. And we've seen Amazon, YouTube, how many more follow suit with that?
Follow the same patterns,
I really say head coaching and entrepreneurship, being a coach and entrepreneur, it's one and the same. I actually, as a head coach now, I started as a head coach last year and now second year as my head coach. And it's like, I've taken a lot of things in my coaching with a unique perspective. I'm always willing to try something. I'm always willing to be creative. I give, you know, I'm transparent with my players. I give them context of everything going on. And I run it more like an organization or a business a lot of the time than I do, or a lean startup, than I do like the old school team. I really want to show and believe that, yes, you can run a successful team with positivity. Yes, you don't have to berate your athletes. You don't have to fall to that old mindset of, well, you have to have that toxic culture and there's a hierarchy. No, everybody has a spot and role in this team. And I think that's where I'm really unique in my strategy. Bless you. I'm really unique in my strategy where most, they just get out there and they start. They focus too much about the task at hand. And I always tell my guys, our short-term goal is to put the best product we can on the field.
Yeah.
The long-term goal is the lessons you learn in this experience, you should be better off than those who did not have this experience in your life. You should be much better because you stepped foot and were a part of this Chardon Lacrosse program under Coach Casey Seaborn and all the staff and the situation I put around. And I really believe that's what's allowed me to thrive, not only in coaching, but in entrepreneurship and business and everything I do. And I always say, it's like, at the end of the day, my role as a coach is to put as many is to guide the ship and to give my players and my team as many opportunities to be successful as possible.
Right.
Their role and their job is to take advantage of those and not let them fall through the wayside. And if they have to live with that that decision of, well, I didn't take advantage of that, I have no room to complain. And in one of those type of theories, and it's no different than, you know, when you become a manager or manager in business or a superior, or you have some sort of level of leadership, everyone thinks a manager, that's when you've made it. No, your job gets harder when you're a manager. When you're overseeing other people, you're no longer just worrying about yourself. You work for everybody now. Everybody thinks like there's a difference between a boss and a leader. The boss is driving and saying, the leader's out there in front. And I always say, guys, there's nothing that I'm asking you I don't do myself. You know, I go to the weight room in the morning. Take care of myself, mind, body, and soul. And I said, I'm doing these things because they're correct. You have to trust me. You have to believe in it. And it was a hard road. I mean, last year we had 17 kids and it was, you know, the year five, all the kids who started the program, year one through four and freshman year, they had graduated. I was left with, you know, some returners and some new guys who never played before. It was a huge learning year. We had to learn how to not only play lacrosse, but how to be a team, how to that right culture. We had to get rid of the entitlement and all those type of issues. And now I'm staring at 40 guys now and three coaches, and we're ready to really make that move. And it's like, it's crazy the difference 1 year can make. But once you commit to the process, you're going to be surprised how soon you'll see results, as long as you stay committed and you just hold yourself accountable, really.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, coaching entrepreneurship, they have very similar characteristics. I mean, playing sports as a kid, you know, has led me to know how to work in a team.
Yep.
You know, all that good stuff that transferred to being an entrepreneur. I know, like you, I'm an entrepreneur. I got a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
My mind's everywhere. Things are always going on. Ideas are flowing in, flowing out. Is there any way, is there any strategy or system you use to keep your ideas in order or organize them?
You know,
because I need some tips, bro.
Yeah, I mean, I always say, I mean, I've made it a point in the last year to really journal, you know, once or twice a day, even if it's 5 minutes in the morning, 5 minutes before bed. And it's, even if it's two sentences, it could be two sentences, just, you know, today was great, looking forward to moving tomorrow. And it's just making sure you have that reflection. But I mean, when I'm having ideas, I'm one of those where I'm able to keep it in my head. And, you know, if it's something that I'm really like, wow, this is something I need to write down, I write it down, or otherwise I'm going to forget it.
Yeah.
But I found that I have a lot of reoccurring thoughts. And if it's really a good thought, I found it, at least in my own head, in my strategy, that it sticks around for a while. Like if I'm thinking, for instance, something on the team, like I want to create this zone trapping defense that takes the best of our man defense and a zone defense and makes it into a high pressure. And I'm like, I've been thinking that out in my head, how to develop it. Now I've written on paper, I've done this, but I don't have any records of it. I've just continuously developed that thought by having self-awareness. And when I have the opportunity to prompt itself, I think, and it's like, how could I do this? Or how could I do better? And, you know, I'm one of those crazy coaches and entrepreneurs where I'm walking around the room or at practice, I'm walking around practice the whole time, just looking, seeing, evaluating, like, what can we do, this and that? Almost really, like I said, that analytical, just, what can we do? And right. I think I really pursue all my entrepreneurial ideas and endeavors and visions under the same approach. You know, I try to keep my experience, my skills at hand, but I don't allow them to crowd and dissuade from what I'm trying to do. And what I mean by that is, I don't want to always do something or do something because that's the way I've always done it or that's the way it's been done. I always want to leave that open. And is there another way? And I think once you allow yourself to say, is there another way, it really cascades into your entrepreneurship, your day-to-day, your own self-habits, your accountability. And you really start to say, I could do that, or this could be different. I'm sure you've had projects where you were like, how can I do this? And you sit down and you're like, I don't know what the hell I'm gonna do. I don't know what the fuck I'm like.
Oh, many times.
And you're like, you just start throwing it to the wall and seeing if it sticks. And sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. But until you take that step, you can't move on. And it's funny because I've read a book called The Lean Startup Method by Eric Ries. And essentially, he combines the lean manufacturing principles that Toyota's famous for, and he essentially puts it into a startup culture. Not necessarily startup we hear now, venture capitalists, but that anything can be a startup, meaning taking a new direction or a new division. Mm-hmm. And I really say the lean startup, I'm not one of those entrepreneurs who's like, you got to read these top 5, top 10 books. I have one book that I think every entrepreneur should read, and it is the Lean Startup Method, because for all those years I had this, I knew the craziness, I knew I had something special, I had that a unique type of brain and thought pattern. When I read this book, I'm like, oh, this makes sense. Literally what I thought is just I have an entrepreneurial mindset, and this book teaches you entrepreneurship from a managerial perspective. How to bring entrepreneurship in as a methodical scientific process. And it's all based on the build, measure, and learn principle. Build the MVP or your minimum viable product. Don't go ends and ends to bake the biggest, best thing. Test one small hypothesis. Measure it. How do the results go? Test it. Test one thing, a value prop. And then learn. You either learn and keep going, or you pivot and take a new direction. It's like, that's literally how entrepreneurs act and operate. And for instance, he got it. Zappos was obviously Amazon, the shoe company, and Amazon bought it. Yeah. Zappos is one of the most famous companies that's followed this lean startup method.
Well, because they have, I mean, I learned that in one of my marketing classes, and they got it. They somehow got in there. In the shoe market, which is, you know, the shoe market's crazy, especially an online shoe market.
Absolutely.
And they figured out how to use customer service and customer-oriented methods and produce a successful company.
Yeah, and it's crazy because...
Shit, could you imagine if Amazon would buy your company? I'd be fucking... Absolutely. That's success right there.
And it's crazy. It's crazy how Zappos started, because Zappos started by the owner literally finding deals in shoes and going to stores and buying. Like, he was like, he would see Payless Shoes or Burlington, and he would see their sales. He'd post them on the website, and as people bought them, he would go to the store and buy those shoes, pack them up, and ship them. He was making zero profit from the start.
Yeah.
He had money saved up. He kept going, and every penny he would make, he saved. He put it back in, and that's where it's crazy, because you see that. That's the truest entrepreneur, from nothing to everything. But then Hewlett-Packard, Toyota, they've had successful runs within following this method as multinational, huge corporations, billion-dollar organizations. And for instance, Toyota, and part of the lean startup manufacturing, there's this concept called Genchi Gobuku. I believe I said that right. And essentially, it's the Japanese philosophy of go out and see. You have to go out and try. Like, for instance, in Japan, they typically don't take long road trips. And Toyota, before they really were redoing the minivan, they said, well, we want to do this minivan. We want to make this Sienna, you know, a flagship type, just like the Camry and RAV4 and so on back in the mid-2000s. Really, when you had Pontiacs and you had Dodge, Plymouth, and the Caravans, those were what dominated the minivan market. And then Ford and Chevy had the Astro vans. The Honda Odyssey and Toyota, they really didn't have that market. So what Toyota did said, their chief product engineer, who was in control of discovering or recreating and designing the whole Sienna, they sent him on a year-long trip through the United States. He traveled to all 50 states in a minivan. He got feedback from people and families that drive minivans. He got feedback from, because he couldn't do that in Japan. They don't go on long road trips. They don't have those long expeditions. Long drives aren't common. It's a small country. When you're geographical size-wise, it wasn't common. He had to go out and see that principle. And it's much like I talk about with that experience. You have to go out and experience those type of things, or how do you know? You don't know what to do.
Yeah,
so he discovered where everybody else was saying, oh, you need to sign based on the parents and that. He said, the focus on the minivan needs to be about kids, cup holders, vacuum in the car. And now if you look just a decade later, the Sienna is the second, or and sometimes back and forth with the Honda, because they follow much of the same methods, is the number one and two selling minivans in the country. It's insane. It's like they were able to dominate a market that had been dominated for two decades by American manufacturers. And why? Ford, Chevy, and Dodge, they didn't focus on the children. They didn't focus on those. They kept focusing on engine performance or how it looks and, you know, all the front dash and navigation and stuff. And I'm sorry, but the main users of a minivan are children.
I kind of feel like when a lot of people are ahead, they kind of lose that, you know, those working moments. Like, we still have to put in the effort. They're like, we're number one.
Yep.
We've been number one for the past 10 decades. Yep. We're obviously doing something right. They're doing something wrong. And it's those people that's, you know, kind of the underdogs.
Absolutely.
They're just focused. we have to, like, not even focus to beat them, but just focus to be number one themselves.
Yep.
Like,
well, yeah, and it's important. I just listened to a Joe Rogan podcast about McGregor fights, and it's same concept of when you have it all, when you're at the top of your game, when you have it all, you have the money, you have the, you're number one.
MySpace.
You have, you're number one. You lose that fight as a poor, like the, like when you're someone fighting rich against someone fighting poor, and in is metaphorical, but like the poor person has something to lose.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
And the rich guy does too, but he doesn't realize, like, he doesn't realize that he needs to put in, that the guy's coming in full swinging, you know, and the rich guy doesn't think, he's like, I got it all. What can happen? Nothing can happen. Yeah. To me, you know,
or what they do in that situation. It's not even, they recognize the threat and they start doing defensive or protectionism techniques. Yeah. I mean, it's
that's what I'm saying. Instead of being working as he used to work to get to before he was at that point or before they were at that point or the company.
Yep.
You know,
and you know, I love that you brought this up because this is something that I've always preached with in, you know, my team. I said, guys, whether you love or hate the New England Patriots, you have to understand that that success breeds success from their culture. And you know why they're so successful? And everybody says, oh, it's Tom Brady's. No, it's not. It doesn't matter. The system they have in place, the culture, is all about, we don't care about anybody else. We don't care about the outside factors. We're going to play the most perfect football game we can because we hold ourselves at a high standard, and it shows. That's how dynasties are created. Yeah. Look at the San Antonio Spurs. Once again, in an era where it was the flashy player, especially in the 90s, it was flashy, it was guard-oriented. They said, we've built this system, Popovich and everybody, we're building this system, a forward-oriented offense, and now we're going to dominate because we know from an analytics and from a just – game planning perspective, you can't beat us if we play this game perfectly. And I mean, that's literally what LeBron faced in the 2007 finals. He said, they exploited my one weakness and did it the whole time, and I didn't do anything. Every time we did a pick and roll, which was all the Cavs had done that year, was pick and roll or like a free five where pounce the outside shooters, you know, LeBron centric. They decided, we're just going to go under on every single screen and make him shoot. And LeBron couldn't do anything. I was devastated when we lost the 07 finals. I was like, we're getting swept. Like,
it's crazy.
And we finished with a better record that year, if I'm not mistaken, than the Spurs. Or it was the year before.
But still, the game, you know.
Yep. And I teach my kids, like, guys, we can't worry about the officials. We can't worry about the other team. We can't worry about the weather. Don't focus on any of the shit that's out of our control. Focus on what we have control of and do that perfectively. Yeah. Do it perfectly. Follow your role. Do your job. And you will see success. And I always tell the guys, and this is a quote that I really love from Dabo Sweeney, not this year, but the year before when he beat Alabama in national championship. He said, you know, what is a team? A team is a group of guys that are coming together to achieve something bigger than any of those kids can do on their own in an individual effort. And it's the same thing in entrepreneurship, starting a business. I mean, that's why I really joined the company I'm on, is because I had job offers in accounting, finance, analyst, consultants. I could have traveled the globe, all this. I had graduate assistant coaching positions all over the country, Colorado, Florida, cool places I want to move. But I said, none of those are giving me the bigger vision. It just didn't, for whatever reason, it's just, I knew that wasn't it. My gut, I listened to my intuition. Where I'm working at OnTech, I was given the opportunity to be a part of something bigger. That if I put a lot of effort in this, I could be six figures. I could get seven figures. I could be a millionaire in 5 to 10 years. And I said, if I'm going to do something and I'm going to do this with a business that's not on my own, I'm going to follow that closest to the sun principle. I'm going to get as close to two entrepreneurs who are successful as possible as I can. And I'm going to learn from them and build from them and provide an unprecedented level of value to them, because I know that value is going to come back to me. And all those jobs and things, I just weren't able to do it. It wasn't until I really approached my job search and the hiring process and finding opportunities in a way where I said, I need to look at all these job applications as an opportunity to bring in business, to showcase my skills. And I even led my interview by saying, you know, I believe that an interview process is nothing more than a normal business transaction. I mean, I was brought in for business development. So I said, fuck it, let's go negotiate. I'm going to negotiate this from the start, nothing to lose.
Less negotiation.
And that's what I said. I said, I'm going to come in here. And it started with just a small business development job because Ken, you know, entrepreneur, didn't have the time to run the business and grow the business, being doing the sales and opportunities, and that he needed somebody to do that. And now my role's grown from just help is a little bit with sales to now I'm running the business development department, branding, marketing, direction, vision, value proposition, service, client management. I'm creating my own guide and growth sales process that I'm going to be able to write and document. It's like, I approached it with a different perspective and that I don't give a fuck attitude and just did what was true to me.
Right.
And I was ready and willing to walk out of that interview and say, I don't have this job. Even though I had parents on my back, I'm living at home, all those type of things where it's like, people would say, you're not even in a position to say no. And I'm like, I am, though. I can always say no because I'm willing to be uncomfortable, yeah. You know. And it's funny, I brought this up senior year, and I told my best friend, Mac, and I said, you know, I really realized something, that the more comfortable you can be in uncomfortable situations, or the less it takes for you to be comfortable, the more opportunities that are there. If you can eat shit and deal with it and you're happy,
right? It's exposure.
The world is,
yeah,
like
it's,
you
exposure,
said,
right?
You have nothing to lose.
You go, you have these fears, you expose yourself to it,
facts.
They don't become fears anymore.
Yeah.
More opportunities open up.
Yep.
Oh, couldn't even imagine myself doing that. You did it.
Yeah.
You know, and I think people fear the idea of exposing themselves. You know,
yeah.
It's a fear of fear, right?
Yeah.
It's a fear of being fearful, of being in a certain situation, or having a certain feeling that you felt before,
mm-hmm.
that you don't want to feel anymore.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. And people don't realize, like, fear is just an instinctual, primitive motivator that is supposed to, essentially, your body senses danger around you and it sees this uncertainty. Now, as we become more and more aware through the evolution of ourselves and our mind and that subconscious and all the different levels of conscious, your body now has that where, instead of just a physical reaction, you have a mental reaction. And people be fine. They know, oh, I'm physically secure. This thing's not going to hurt me. Jumping in this interview, I'm not going to get physically harmed. But they just can't get past that mental, like, the insecurities, the doubts, the fears. And really, that's why we have such a problem with mental health in our country, is because what do? We prescribe pills and things that solve for anxiety, depression, OCD. You just prescribe things that have physical, chemical reactions and balances and effects. So now somebody who's dealing with anxiety, depression, and they're having a panic attack, now their body's even saying, what are you worrying about? We're completely relaxed. So now nothing but your brain can focus on is, say you're taking, like, you know, an Xanax or something like that. Now your mind's just going crazy. If your signs of mental illness aren't from a physical source, chemical imbalance, nutrition deficiency or something like that, you're now treating the wrong source, and it's now making your issue 10 times worse. I mean, it's not a coincidence why the suicide rate of people that suffer from mental depression that are on SSRIs or the serotonin receptor inhibitors versus those who aren't are astoundingly higher for those who are on those type of physical dependencies.
You become reliant on stuff.
We're prescribing a pill for a solution that is not physical. You're not subscribing. Just like, for instance, I always teach, and one of the biggest questions I get asked as a coach is, your guys are confident. How do you build confidence in somebody? And I said, it's simple. I give them opportunities to challenge them and let them build their confidence, and I encourage them to take advantage of those opportunities. For instance, confidence really is built by completing small challenges and obstacles that you can refer to when you're dealing with a bigger situation than anything you've faced before. You know, I've shot free throws in the dark. I've shot free throws, you know, 100 free throws in a row. I made 20 in a row after gassers and being dead at practice. Now when I'm stepping up at the end of the game, I got to hit 2 free throws. I know I can do it, because I've had all those experiences. Or at least, even if I'm not successful doing it, I have the confidence that I can, because of all the preparation behind. And that's where I really think entrepreneurs, coaches, a lot of people struggle with that, especially creatives, where they almost jump too early and they think that they can do this a massive thing right away, and it just obliterates their confidence, esteem, and worth. And it's like, you should just start with something small, one thing at a time. I'm not saying be singular focused, but you need to have enough awareness to be able to say, I'm going to lock in on this. Is my this is my mission for the next hour. I'm just going to get it done. I'm sure you've had it where you're editing, you're like, I don't want to do this, but that editing is what's going to make you better. You have to get through it. It's just like a workout. Like, if that doesn't come natural, like for me, I've always loved the gym. I've always hated, you know, like running and, you know, physical therapy and those different types of things, but I love the weight room. I love training, conditioning. I've dealt with a lot of athletes and kids, great athletes, can't stand it whatsoever. And it's like, they had to just say, I know I need to do this for an hour and a half because it's what's going to get me better, and I'm going to be better at the thing I really love doing, which is being a player or being an athlete, that I just have to swallow my pride and do it. And I really think that you have to constantly challenge yourself. And I think after you graduate college in the mid-20s, there's that trap of, what road am I going to go down?
It's a lot of pressure.
Yeah. Am I going to go the safe route? Am I going to go conservative? Which people use those words, but really it's just complacency and stagnation.
Yeah.
You don't try to be better. You're okay with where you are. You say, this is who I am. And you do that for 40 to 60 years till you freaking die. And that's it. Or you say, I want a bigger life. I want to pursue personal excellence. I want to do something bigger. I always want to be getting better and through experiences. And I want to challenge myself on a day-to-day basis. And it's like, I can promise you the first one, you might have fun. That might be your motivation. And if it is, fine. I'm not saying that's right or wrong. If you're complaining, then you need to go the other way about it. Because I had this conversation with Mac the other day. He's like, you know, I just can't stand when people don't want to challenge themselves, or they're like, they're so okay with having a job and working and they think they're doing well. I'm like, well, Mac, you have to understand, not everybody's success motivated. Not everybody's that grand vision or doing things out of the ordinary motivated. Well, some people are family social and want a good, conservative, balanced life.
It depends
motivated.
What success means. Exactly. I mean, success could mean a family. Success could mean the ability to have a job, only put in the effort at those hours, go home and not have to worry about it.
Exactly.
You know, that could be success to them.
Yeah. But my thing is, if you're complaining and you want more, then put down the Xbox.
I agree.
Get off and stop going out to drink every weekend and pissing $40 to $120, $200 if you go to the casino and strip clubs like I always see, and more.
Yeah.
And put that money in your business. And it's
or
funny
in yourself. Like, yeah, do exactly. something that you've always wanted to do.
Yep.
Pursue it. And that's my biggest pet peeve, too, is when people sit there and they complain. And they bitch and moan about their situation, but realistically, I see it. I'm like, dude, you have a great situation.
Yeah.
Use it to your advantage. Find these hobbies. Find these self-driving factors that'll make you better and will add value to your life.
Yeah, that's because you have that opportunistic mindset. That's the thing. You wouldn't be here if you didn't. You have that. You see more of the opportunities, that abundance mindset where there's so much opportunity. How many people do you hear? It's like, oh, well, the cannabis industry is already done. You can't even get in. You already have to be in. Or the tech industry, you can't even get in. It's like, that is such a horrible, limited mindset to have. Like, that's a scarcity mindset. You need that abundance mindset that there's so much success out there that it's yours to go get. It's just that no one's going to hand it to you. You got to go work for it and get it. And it's like, once you commit to that, you're fine. And that's where one of the biggest things I see with new entrepreneurs, so say they've made that choice and they've said, all right, I'm doing this. I want to choose this personal route. But the first time they get that paycheck from entrepreneurship or whatever their endeavor is, what do? They don't put 25% for their taxes. They don't put 50% in for their business running operations. They take it and they buy something with it.
Yeah.
They buy something.
Instead of reinvesting.
They feed their insecurities, their doubts, and be like, oh, I need to make sure it looks like I'm doing this. I'm still driving around the 2006 Nissan Titan with 174,000 miles that I drove in high school, and I'm keeping that truck for 2 to 3 years because I'm like, why would I get a new vehicle? It serves my purposes. I can make money with it. Why? So other people it looks like. And I still get compliments on the truck. It's an older truck, and it's like, I'm going to drive that thing in the ground because it allows me to have freedom.
Yeah,
I mean, it's like living at home.
What you value. You value, you know,
freedom.
And putting it, and putting money into yourself. You value taking your money, reinvesting it. Some people, they don't understand value. They, you know, to them, the car maybe is everything.
Yeah.
But I agree with you.
Yeah.
You know, like, there's no need to, I think with Gary Vee sound bites and stuff like
that. Yeah, people get the wrong, but
they he's get got the wrong a, idea that, yeah. I mean, and with this materialistic culture that we have, people feel like they have to constantly be getting better shit, better than their next door neighbor, better than everyone else. And they think that is success.
Yeah.
But it's false. It's made by these companies that are advertising. And people don't realize it, though.
And people don't realize marketing is nothing more than the psychological understanding of how people react to different patterns, trends, and things that they see.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what marketing is. I mean, that's why I really think I'm a successful, like, when I really look at myself and I'm like, people say, well, business development, they're like, isn't that sales? And it's like, no, sales is a tool of what I do within business development. Business development's all about the curation and development of leads, opportunities, and successful ventures that can bring growth and opportunity to a business, organization, or self.
Right.
And that's, I use sales as a tool, but I also use branding. I use value proposition. I use client retention. I do customer service. Like, it's a huge realm, and it provides a better longer-term picture than to do the short-term sales. I always say sales is the short-term reward. It's like anything in life. You can choose the easy way or the short-term way, or you can choose the hard way with the long-term way. And what I mean by that is sales is often short-term. It's predicated about, what can I do to get you to close today? What can I get you to do to sign this contract? Business development's the long road saying, I'm doing this because I want to provide value to you, because you bet in me, and I'm just so grateful that you decided to trust me and my skills and experience. I want to give you value, that 51-49 principle. And that's something every time I start a conversation with a lead, a client, anybody I talk to, I say, you know, part of this guide and grow philosophy on this first conversation, I'm not here to sell you at all. And I don't. I'm simply here and I say, I'm here to identify points of value. I'm here to look and identify and help understand the challenges and the difficulties you're facing in your business, and to see if we're a mutual point of value that we can help you out and show you what we can do. If we're not, I'm going to point you in the right direction. And we do all the time. I turn away business all the time because I said, you don't need to pay for us, because you could pay that web developer and it'll be a lot less expensive and they'll do a better job than us. And that just builds trust and branding, but it's that long-term commitment. And people don't want to see that. They're so worried about what's on my plate today. What do I have today? What do I have tomorrow? That they don't think, what do I have in the future? And it's just like, entrepreneurs start a business. And if they, instead of taking those $500 out to buy yourself a watch or do this and that, put that $500 in, because that's going to give you 5-6 years of your business potentially. That's going to constantly feed you. And it's like,
yeah,
you really have to put in, and I always say, put it in as much as you can and put off the reward as long as possible, and you will see success.
Yeah.
If you're able to say, I'm going to give release and I'm not going to go out once a month. Like, say I love partying and being social. All right, we'll use that as a motivator now. You get one day a month to go out. Go out one day a month. Now you're going to make it an awesome experience. You're going to make it a great experience. Like, I've always been that type, especially when it comes to leisure, social. I could not stand when guys would, drink till 10 o'clock. We'd hang out, go to an apartment, hang out till midnight. Then they go to the bar till 2:30, and then they come home. We do the same thing every weekend. I'm like, we're not even doing anything. We're not living. We're literally just going to a bar and pissing money away. I'd rather, start drinking at 4 and go to a concert and then go to a party and then go to the casino and do this and make one big experience out of it and get it all in once and go full in versus just constantly doing a little bit there in that end. Yeah. And it's like, you need to find out, if you're an entrepreneur, what motivates you? What are the things you like? And what rewards you? What's those things that you just love doing? Like, for me, I love playing Xbox. I've always loved gaming, and I really love playing like Rocket League and 2K. So I set myself during the week, I don't get to do that until I've made sure I've gotten everything done that day. If I still have stuff to do at 10 o'clock at night or 9 o'clock at night or 8 o'clock, I don't do it. I don't play. I say, I haven't earned it yet. I got to wait till tomorrow once I'm done and I have, I can play for 30 minutes or an hour. And it's like, that self-control and discipline, you have to have it as an entrepreneur, and it's what's going to breed success.
No, exactly. I couldn't agree with you more. Great tips. I think that's just an amazing place to end this podcast. If you take away anything from this, just take away work hard, believe in yourself. Always pay attention to long-term goals. Don't always think short-term.
Yep.
It's very important. Thank you again, Casey, for being here.
Absolutely.
Do you have any projects going on or anything that you want to talk about?
Yeah, so currently, obviously, I'm going to be the lead sponsor, and obviously with Freeway Film, which I'm just excited you guys that be involved in that. That's going to be the first official Casey and Cleveland sponsored project. So that was an opportunity for me to get involved, and I think all I did was DM say, because I saw you had like the website for funding. I was like, they're going to take money from you. No, I want you to have all the money. Do what you need to do as a creative. And that's awesome. And then obviously I'm wearing this shirt. This is for Don Kenobi. I'd love if you guys checked it out. Walsh alum, rapper, artist. He's been doing this for years. He has an awesome album out and it's called Full Circle. He has a song called Feeling Alive that I'm actually involved on creating the music video and that. And it's just doing whatever I can. It's like, I love doing that. Obviously the season's starting soon for Chardon Lacrosse. So this is our first year as a varsity sponsored school sport. So we're trying to make a bang, and I'm trying to leave this legacy of Chardon Lacrosse started on the right note. So, I mean,
awesome.
Lots of stuff going on. Then on tech, I could talk all day about what we got going on over there as the startup. So that's all day.
Well, where can the people find you at?
Best place to find me is Instagram or LinkedIn at Casey in Cleveland. All my social media sites, YouTube, Twitter, you name it, is Casey in Cleveland, except for TikTok. It's just a one at the end. Got to figure that out, how I get rid of that. But you can find me there, and I'm in the process of developing a website. I really want to reach out to anybody watching this. If you have questions, comments, concerns, you just want some direction from an entrepreneur, a creative, a business experienced person and professional, direct message me, call me, text me, 440-251-7783. Get in contact with these two guys and they'll point you in my direction. I love helping. I love giving, having those phone calls and doing those one-on-ones. And it's something I like to do for free. So take advantage of it. Use me. Take whatever I have and take it. It's what I want to do. So
awesome. It's
the biggest way.
Great.
Awesome.
It was great having you. Thanks for being on here. Absolutely. A lot of great content.
Yep.
A lot of great motivations. Hope people got a lot out of it.
Yep.
You have anything else, Will?
Yeah, I'm going to just, kind of repeat what he said.
Yep.
I think everybody should take self-awareness from this. Yeah. Know who you are, know what you want to do, and go for it. So I'm going to leave off on that note.
All right. Yeah, well, everyone, it's been real.
Yep.
It's been real. And it's your boy Chef T.
What a Space Kid.
Casey in Cleveland.
Thanks for watching and listening, and keep it real, y'all.
Thank you all for listening and joining us on another episode of the Stirfry. All the music was created by Steve Ozell, so check him out on all streaming services at Steve O Music, spelled STV30Music. Also, if you enjoyed this podcast, please subscribe and leave a review. We'd greatly appreciate it. Thanks again to our sponsor, Nuclear Printing. They're a custom apparel business printing things from t-shirts and hoodies to hats and more. Check them out on Instagram at Nuclear Printing, spelled NUCLEAR Printing. See you next Tuesday when we talk with a Cleveland barber named Yaya. She talks about her path to becoming a barber and challenges she faces being a woman in a male-dominated industry. So see you next week, and keep it real.